Welcome, everybody, to the Riata Report. It is Tuesday, November 13th, 2018. It is 10 o'clock p.m. We're starting a little late tonight. This, of course, is Paul McGinley live from Toledo, Ohio, along with Brian Weinstein, Bridgeton, New Jersey, also live. And we've got a guest, Chuck Grau from New Hampshire. We're going to be talking about... let's start. I still think there's a political fallout from the elections, Chuck and Brian. Looks like the White House is in some greater amount, degree of dysfunction than usual. All kinds of people are being fired, and there's a lot of infighting going on. Elections are still, some tight contested races are still being finally tabulated. All kinds of stuff's going on. What to make of all this? Any comments?
Well, Arizona flipped, right? It was originally called, the Senate race in Arizona was originally called for the Republican. Now the Democrat has won that that race. Both of the major statewide races in Florida are subject to recount, and all of our recount deja vu from the 2000 election. There have been multiple lawsuits filed with respect to that recount already. I think the White House is certainly angry about the result in the House of Representatives, a result I think that really was well within the norms of a regular off-year election, and not the kind of massive blue wave the Democrats were hoping for. But nonetheless, it flipped one branch of government. That means for the first time since Trump has been in office, there's the potential of congressional oversight for what he does. And he's unhappy about that. He's taken the opportunity to sack the Attorney General Beauregard Sessions, and who really was probably one of the worst, if not the worst, Attorney General in the history of the United States of America. We have a crisis, a scandal brewing over the appointment that he made. It's been challenged in court now by the state of Maryland, in the context of an ongoing lawsuit in federal court that the state of Maryland has over the interpretation and application of the Affordable Care Act. They filed a motion today asking the court to rule that the interim attorney general appointment made by Trump to be unconstitutional. That motion, I think, has a reasonable chance of success.
There's apparently some infighting between the Homeland Security faction and his cabinet as well. And you mentioned the lawsuit from CNN on Jim Acosta.
And then there's the lawsuit that CNN and Acosta brought, asking for an injunction mandating that the White House reinstate his White House press credentials.
Yep, it looks like a big mess right now, Chuck. And then from a trade standpoint, there's no clear policy regarding trade with China or what the future direction might be. There's disagreement on that. Larry Kudlow came out to call another cabinet member, well, not quite a cabinet member, but one of Trump's team as being irresponsible regarding pushing hard for tariffs against China. I mean, there's just a lot of disarray, dysfunction coming out of the White House right now. Can't say I'm not too unhappy to see it, I must say.
Well, it's going to get worse as these different episodes play out, and it could get a lot worse if the recounts in Florida you know, flip the results that were reported on election night.
Mm-hmm. Increase the majority. Yeah.
It could get a lot worse.
Right.
And we're already dealing with people in the White House and in the Senate majority and the leadership and much of the rank and file of the Republican Party that have demonstrated a really disappointing and reprehensible lack of respect for even the minimal kind of democracy, you know, that we've had in the United States. They just seem antithetical to it, and all they want is, you know, one party rule, and they're being challenged on a number of fronts, and you have to wonder if, you know, when they start losing, what lengths they will go to undo any, you know, lawful challenges to their rule.
In the meantime, we've got some Florida recounts going, right? I mean, we've got the governor and the Senate seat still uncertain. I suppose it's unlikely either will flip.
Well, it's hard to tell. I mean,
never know.
Things tightened up a good deal during the 2000 recount, and apparently there were all kinds of early votes and absentee votes and military votes that had not been counted at the time the election was called last week. Mm-hmm. So it's hard to tell where exactly those are going to come down.
Right, right. The military votes, one would assume, would go Republican, but you never know, right?
You just don't know.
You just don't know.
That's the reason you count the votes.
And who would be troubled to the extent where they'd have to place an absentee vote? Is it a voter who is under demands from work, in which case one suspects that might lead to a Democrat vote? I don't know why people post absentee votes. Probably, any thoughts on that, Chuck O'Brien? Why do people post?
Well, I've voted absentee any number of times because, you know, I worked in one city and voted in another, and you know, during much of the time that the polls were open, you know, I was really outside of the voting jurisdiction. And so I was unable to go to vote during the hours, and so I qualified under the state statutes for absentee ballots. But usually it's every state will have specific legal requirements for when you can vote, you know, absentee, and they're typically that you anticipate not being in the jurisdiction at the time of the vote, or you're sick. Or have some other enumerated, you know, reason.
So it's very hard to divine in which directions those votes will.
I think so. I mean, for example, in New Hampshire, take like the New Hampshire primary, it's held in February or January. God knows, you know, they keep pushing it back. Someday maybe it'll be held in December. But a lot of senior citizens. Snowbird down in Florida. So at the time of the election, they're not in New Hampshire, they're in Florida. So they
right.
They would qualify, and many of them actually do vote absentee.
I think one of the ironic things is that it would seem like a lot of the military folks would be voting absentee. And again, the irony of it is that Trump says he's behind the military, but he wants the votes cut off. So you can see what a hypocrite the SOB is, just as much as he's a hypocrite not showing up for the centennial for the armistice.
Well, can we discuss this generally about why the military tends to vote Republican?
Because the Republicans give them more than what they want, generally. They feel they're going to get more support from the Republicans.
I think, yeah, there's an ideology that the Republican Party is much more supportive of the military and the use of the military.
Trump dismantles wrong. Their VA. You know, Trump's dismantling their VA benefits and health benefits and forcing them into the private sector. I don't see that as support.
No. That's absolutely true. But there's a divergence between the support for military in general and military operations and a big military and the ego of the military and the ego of the people in the military and the way that they're actually treated as members of the military. Thank you for your service. By the way, we're taking away TRICARE. Thank you for your service. By the way, we're cutting back VA services.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I've gotten to know, young men primarily that were in the Army with my son, and I think that there's a lot of ambivalence. There's some cognitive dissonance. One of the interesting things is that I find in talking with him and some of his peers is that there's an awful lot of libertarian sentiment within the military.
Yeah.
It's very interesting.
Well, you know, Chuck, it's even worse. It's not just thank you for your service. It's also thank you for your service. Plus, we've got a record defense budget. None of it's going to your benefits. Sorry. You know, I mean, it's really terrible. If you think about it, I mean, let's increase taxation to build up military, you know, to spend towards defense. Oh, by the way, none of that goes towards the VA benefits or no increases, you know.
It could prove to be a fatal mistake. I mean, the day the Russian Revolution turned was the day that the Army refused to fight for the Tsar.
Mm-hmm. True.
And that has happened elsewhere. So, you know, you've got to wonder.
But, you know, Chuck, okay, I'm trying to remember back, you know, my readings on that. And I suppose you'd have to have the minor military functionaries had gone against the Tsar first, of course, for the regiment or the brigade to go against the Tsar. It's the officer corps. The officer corps had to have turned first, obviously.
And well, it's way more complicated than I.
Yeah, because I don't see our officer corps suddenly turning Democrat. I may be wrong, but hopefully they would be willing. Yeah, any thoughts on that, Brian? You know anything?
No, as I said, I just think that in general, the Republicans are seen as more pro-military, so it's in their interests. On the other hand, I have to say that if you are, don't forget, a lot of the minorities make up a lot of the servicemen fighting overseas. They're the ones usually actually doing the fighting, and they're going to support Trump in many cases. And there are people overseas too, so it's hard to say. I think the problem is that Trump, he's a bloviator, and he just automatically says there's fraud. He doesn't want vote. It looks very bad for the Republican Party, for them to try to limit the vote. I mean, why would you do this? I mean, first of all, again, you're accusing them of fraud, and there's no proof. You want to shut down the election immediately. What does that say to the party? I mean, it just shows you they're acting like they're fascists, because they are.
The contempt for democracy, contempt for the simple prerequisites and the simple operations of the most elemental forms of democracy. And the sad thing is, a lot of their base thinks that's fine, because in the end, to them, all that matters is being in power.
Yeah, yeah. The base does support it, no doubt about it. You know, it doesn't hurt him, his base at all, when he resorts to this kind of dirty tactics.
I'm wondering, in general, how all of this is, because we don't hear anything about this, how all of this nastiness toward minorities, especially African Americans, is affecting recruitment. Because I don't see a lot of Republicans that are ready to fight on the line. I could see them wanting to go to West Point or or ordering somebody else to fight. But I don't see a lot of them, like the Trumps of the world, get physically involved. And I'm just wondering if they're meeting their recruitment goals. I have no idea one way or another. But I would think that it's effective.
I would imagine that there's a small percentage that actually do see fighting, right? No? I mean, I don't know. That's
right, but they still have to be ready. I mean, the troops still have to be ready whether they're actually fighting or not. They still have to, you know, train for it. And I don't know that Whitey has the stomach for it.
No, I don't think Whitey has the stomach for
it. Yeah, the Russian Whiteys do, but not the Republican Whiteys.
Well, I can tell you most of the guys in my son's unit, you know, were white and probably secondarily Hispanic.
Mm-hmm.
And they were combat troops. They were infantry. You know, they 11 Bravos. They were in some deep shit for a long time. And in fact, next to the Marines in Helmand Province and the 101st Airborne, the next area of operation, their unit in the time that they were there had the third highest rate of casualties of any other unit in the American Army. So,
is your son, may I ask, is he more liberal or is he conservative?
I would say his politics largely align with mine for whatever that's worth.
That's worth a lot to us. Okay.
I can tell you he taught me how to shoot an AK-47 and an ACR.
Well, I know what an AK-47 is. What's an ACR?
Advanced combat rifle. It's a much improved version of an M4.
I'm not very good with weaponry. I know what a bow and arrow is, and a slingshot, and that's about it.
When I started seeing all of these
BB guns.
Neanderthals show up at Obama rallies slinging semi-automatic rifles over their shoulders, I figured it wasn't going to be safe for me any longer. If they couldn't keep these cretins away from the President of the United States, that nobody was going to save me except me. And,
pretty scary.
I mean, that could be their yahoos in the neighborhood here. I mean, there's a guy around the corner who I learned planted some fake pipe bombs across the street, right across the street from my house, because he was pissed.
That's New Hampshire for you folks.
Yeah, well, hey, he was pissed that they had subdivided the farm and turned it into a residential area. And you know what I was told. Well, this guy, you know, in the last Obama election, 2012, he had this display outside of his house, and there was an Obama sign that had those arrows, and the arrow was pointing down into a toilet. And I'm chatting with one of my neighbors, and she's telling me about I mentioned that to her, and she says, well, you know, he's the guy, you know, that the police arrested for planting this fake pipe bombs across the street here. And she, according to her, the police, you know, went, you know, and searched his house and found all these automatic weapons and all this ammunition and all this stuff, and he is kind of, you know, a whack job, apparently.
This is not so funny, Chuck.
Well, you want to know why I've got AK-47s in the house. So I come back to the house, and it's now 5:15 in the afternoon. The next day, Obama is flying into Manchester, New Hampshire, you know, right before the election to, you know, hold a rally. And this guy, you know, is out here with his arsenal, his Looney Tune behavior, apparently, and his animus. So I walk in. It's 5:15. I find the number for the Manchester, New Hampshire office of the Secret Service. I call him up. I get a recording. We're sorry, the office is closed. Now, this is the day before the President of the United States is coming to Manchester, New Hampshire. Okay? The recording is on at the Secret Service. So I leave a message, you know, kind of saying what happened. And I go out and I start, you know, grilling dinner for my wife in the backyard. 15 minutes later, she comes out the door. She's holding a phone. She says, it's a telephone call for you. I'm like, who is it? She says, it's the New York office of the Secret Service. They want to talk to you.
Cool.
Yeah, so I talked to him, and the guy said, well, you know, he says, we can't do anything about it just because you disagree with this guy's politics. I said, whether I agree with his politics or disagree, it seems to me to be immaterial. I said, you asked me whether I have seen this guy's guns. No, I haven't seen this guy's guns, but let me tell you, this is what I heard. You know, if it's true, call the Bedford police. They would have done an investigation. They're the ones that would have seen the stuff. I don't want to tell you how to do your job, but if I were you, I would call them and I would ask them that question. Right. I just heard this stuff. I know that the president's coming tomorrow. I thought maybe it's my responsibility as a citizen to bring it to your attention. If you don't want to do anything about it, hey, that's on you. I think I've discharged my responsibilities. Nothing happened, but, you know, but anyway, my point is that there's all these kooks out there. You know, these shootings happen all over the place. You know, this guy or some other guy around here could go off half cocked anytime. And I just like, I hated guns. My dad was a hunter. He had all kinds of guns. He wanted me to do this. He wanted me to do that. I didn't want to have anything to do with it. But when these guys, you know, started showing up at Obama rallies, and then I find out that some of the local talent is, you know, part of the Looney Tune Brigade, I'm like, my son came home from leave when he was in Afghanistan. And he walks in the door and he says, Dad, I got you a birthday present. I'm like, what's that? He says, it's an AK-47 and 1,000 rounds of 7.62 Soviet. He says, I'm going to teach you how to use it. And I'm like, you know, it used to be, I was like, get the damn thing out of here. I don't want to have anything to do with it. But after I see what I see, I'm like, you better teach me how to use the damn thing. I might have to.
I can see a title brewing for this video tonight.
Well, you know, depression runs high with chess players, Chuck. You know, we got to be careful.
Chess player with a Kalashnikov. I don't know. The worst thing that ever happens to me is I've been hit by a pillow, but that's about it. So,
well, count your blessings.
Yeah. No, I'm just joking there. I've been hit plenty, but never shot. So that's quite a good thing. I wanted to ask both of you, you know, we know that Trump has been seen as being unhinged, but have you seen an increase in his unhingedness the last week or so since the election? At least I think I've noticed this with the Acosta situation.
I think so. I think he's acting more irrational than usual.
And that might play out for the Democrats in a nice way, because even the most conservative Republicans don't want to see him just completely go off and become, you know, psychotic, so to speak. I mean, the man could be sick.
They demonstrated no ability and no desire to rein him in or hold him accountable in any way, shape, or form. And
ultimately, it's a failure of the Republican Party.
If he goes psychotic, they'll be like, hey, Heil psychosis.
Right.
Yeah. They're getting what they deserve. Flake and crew. You know, Flake Wright rides off into the sunset. You know, he's going to get some kind of corporate sunset deal for voting in Kavanaugh. And then his seat flips. You know, so I thought he was showing some heroic signs there during the hearings. And then in the end, you know, it's the corporate parachute.
He was all filling and no pastry.
Yeah.
All sizzle and no steak.
Yeah.
The guy's
a
fraud. Flake is just a fraud.
Yeah.
You know, when push came to shove, you know.
He showed his true colors. There was no McCain in him, you know. No McCain.
McCain was the only one.
Don't get going on McCain.
I just like McCain's last.
Well, he did do this. You know, that was good. That was a real good one when he went like that.
Yeah.
We got that out of him. So.
Yeah, he had to be in his deathbed to do it.
But he's no Barry Goldwater, is what you're saying, Chuck, I assume. None of them are. There's no Barry Goldwaters left, are there? They've all switched party, essentially, or become independents. So it's a real sad situation. But, you know.
Well, do you want to talk about any of these lawsuits?
Well, I certainly want to talk about the possibilities. It seems, though, it's getting closer and closer to Mueller time. We haven't heard about an indictment lately, but it seems like Roger Stone, perhaps Donald Trump Jr., and perhaps one of the accomplices with Roger Stone will be landed with an indictment soon. What do you think? It's got to be soon, right? I mean, you can't. I mean, I'm actually getting sick and tired of waiting for Mueller to do something, and I'm a liberal. I mean, what are they waiting for? Is there something going on that's making Mueller wait? It seems like they seemingly have everything they could possibly get. They've already indicted so many people. What more does it take to get? There's only a few more, right? You've got Roger Stone, you got Donald Trump Jr., maybe Ivanka. You've got Trump himself, maybe a few others on the periphery that are left, but he's kept going up the ladder. I just don't know what he's waiting for.
Well, it may be that he's waiting, you know, to accumulate the evidence that he feels comfortable with going forward with an indictment or going forward
right.
with a grand jury with.
Now, what evidence, I mean, is somebody still wired in some way, or is there something going on that they need to get, do you think? I mean, I don't think anybody, any Republican will trust anybody now because they would have assumed that everybody's wired up.
I mean, maybe it's just to coalesce what they've got.
I think it's very difficult to speculate in what's going on inside an investigation. And I say that from having run investigations. And, you know, when you're on the outside, all you can do is, you know, speculate. And I just...
Maybe it's on the financial end. Maybe they're waiting on that. I mean, could that be? I know they were trying to get a lot of records from the Deutsche Bank. It seems like the money trail is really important in the collusion, right? I mean, that seems like a link there. I mean, for example, I mean, those homes in southern Florida that were sold at over twice their value. I mean, it was kind of obvious what was going on since they're selling the homes that were originally priced at $40 million and they become $97 million. I think we've talked about this before, Chuck. But I think you yourself have said it's kind of like an obvious money laundering situation there. I think that's the kind of information that's going to help with the collusion aspect.
I don't know how those are going to play out. From the limited amount of what I can see, I think we're going to see more corruption,
more cheating
claims, more corruption prosecutions. The collusion, I think, is much. It's a much harder case. But
essentially, that'll be a conspiracy charge, correct?
I would expect that.
Mm-hmm.
We just want to see him in jail, Chuck.
Well, I would be happy. You see, what I'm thinking, I don't know what you're thinking, Chuck, is that if they really want to get Trump out of there, I mean, it seems like just getting his son, putting his son under pressure. First of all, I don't know what that will do. Would his son squeal on the father? What? I don't know. What will he do? Because he wants to protect his son, because, of course, he wants to protect himself. But it just seems like, you know, I just have a feeling that they are going to have some indictments very soon. It seems like everybody's saying this. But if anybody's going to be indicted, I would think it'd be Roger Stone. And then after that, you see what Stone does. Does he give in and say, okay, I'm going to throw Trump Jr. under the bus or Trump under the bus? I mean, that would seem like the pecking order. But Roger Stone doesn't seem to be wanting to give in at all. I mean, he seems like such a slime ball as it is. I mean, you'd agree he seems like a slime ball, right?
No, I think he's got that track record, yeah.
Yeah, he's a real son of a gun. In fact, all of them, everybody that's been involved in this thing, everybody's been indicted, seems like just a flat-out liar. You know, and, you know, how long can we tolerate this? So
it's easier for me to comment on, you know, lawsuits that actually have been filed.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like the motion that the Maryland Attorney General today filed in their lawsuit in federal court over the Affordable Care Act, where they sought the judge to rule the interim appointment of Whitaker as acting Attorney General to be unconstitutional.
Mm-hmm.
Now, all right, we talked about that off air, right? And not on air yet. But I think that what they're claiming there is that Trump does not have the constitutional authority to appoint a principal officer of the federal government without the advice and consent of the Senate. And he has not gotten the advice and consent of the Senate for Whitaker.
Right.
It was a case in the Obama administration that was very similar to this, where Obama appointed some guy to be the head of the National Labor Relations Board. And it was kind of a pocket appointment where he did not seek advice and consent of the Senate. And it got litigated, and the appointment ended up getting nullified because of that. And I think in that case, they found that the head of the NLRB was a principal officer in the meaning of the Constitution, and there's already litigation to the effect that the Attorney General of the United States certainly is a principal officer within right. the meaning of the Constitution. And one of the legal consequences of that is that anything that the person wrongfully appointed to one of these positions does is null and void. And the argument that the Maryland AG is making is that the proper interim administrator for the Justice Department should be the Deputy Attorney General Rosenstein.
Right, Rosenstein, right.
Rosenstein, who right. Trump doesn't like.
Right.
But who was appointed with the advice and consent of the Senate.
Right.
Now, that case, I think, is a pretty solid one. And the Maryland Attorney General has standing to raise it because the Attorney General makes decisions in the underlying Affordable Care Act case that Maryland is litigating. You know, if you or I just came out and brought the same lawsuit, court would throw it out and say we didn't have legal standing to bring the case.
Right.
Because we were not directly involved with any decision making being made by the Attorney General the acting Attorney General that we were challenging. Not true with respect to Maryland, because they are directly affected and by the decisions that this guy would be making in handling the ACA case that they're involved with. So I think that's a development that's, you know, we talked about turning the heat up on Trump. I think that really will turn the heat up on Trump because it's a pretty solid case.
Mm-hmm.
And it's better, I think, a better case than the one that CNN and Acosta
right.
Filed. And I don't remember whether we were talking about that online or offline, but that case has problems, I think, because of the
Let's bring up the subject. What should be a permissible conduct between a civilian and the President of the United States? If the president of the United States acts aggressively, physically aggressive, or I'm not saying Trump did that, but I can't, I can certainly see him doing that one day. What are the rights of the citizen? Does the president have some kind of extraterritorial rights to physically bully people without any kind of response? I mean, has there been any precedence for this historically? I can't think of any, but there must be. I think Andrew Jackson must have been a spark plug.
You mean, you know, an assault and battery committed by the president of the United States?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, Andrew Jackson probably came really close to this. I mean, are you familiar with that at all, Chuck? I mean, you know, he was supposed to be a spark plug, you know. I do have a book on Jackson. I haven't read it yet. That's still on my upcoming reading list. But, you know, it makes you wonder. It makes you wonder. I mean, poor Acosta. I mean, he's got to sit there and just be the recipient of a torrent of verbal abuse, right, from this man who's got some kind of extraterritorial rights, you know, over him.
Well, verbal abuse is one thing. Physical assault and battery is something else. There's a thing called the Federal Torts Claim Act, and, uh-huh, you know, it's been years since I've had a case that involved it, but it gives some pretty broad immunity to the federal government and to enumerated federal officials for a whole range of torts. I don't think that it, you know, covers certain intentional torts, but, you know, like a battery, I would have to look at the statute. But I had a number of people suggest to me that Acosta and CNN ought to sue Trump for libel, you know, because Trump, you know, would say you're making fake news and you're a bad person.
Right.
And I'm sorry, you know, A, I don't think it's libel, and B, even if it was libel, Trump and his press secretary, Sanders, would be immune from the lawsuit under the Federal Torts Claims Act. So it's a loser. Now, the claim that CNN and Acosta brought is based on the Constitution, the First Amendment, and said that Trump is I'm glad you're finding this amusing.
But Phosphorus 72 asks, what about body slamming? Suppose Trump body slams Acosta and his wig falls off. I mean, I don't know, you know. I don't know. The funny things you think about as you watch this live, you know. I mean, there should be a minimum expectation of a decorum or politeness on the part of our leader, you know. Instead, we've got this guy acting like a baboon, you know.
Well, I mean, there is, but it's come to resemble more like WWF.
In fact, Trump was in the WWF, wasn't he, prior to, I think?
Yes, he was. He got in a fight with
somebody.
He was
one of the guest stars. Right. You know? I mean, he brought the WWF mentality to the post.
I can't imagine that doughboy would last any more than 30 seconds.
Hey, Charles, I have to admit to you, this is something that I've done for many, many years. Paul and I, you know, there's some synchronicity. So when he starts laughing, I know that something's funny. I don't even know what it is, but I'll just start laughing. So I saw Paul laughing out of nowhere, and you were talking basically seriously, and all of a sudden he starts laughing, and that was my cue.
It was Phosphorus's suggestion of body slamming that got me going.
Well, no, I'm used to it. The judges have reacted like that to me for years.
Oh my gosh! We've got cool audience. They're funny.
Acosta's questioning was aggressive, but that's really, you know, somebody's got to be aggressive about the questioning. When you watch Parliament and you watch, you know, the question period. which I think is a great process, and one which, unfortunately, you know, we don't follow. There's aggressive questioning of the prime minister, and there's some real, you know, back and forth that takes place. Mm-hmm. And the closest we get to that is in these press conferences, where most of the time the questions, the reporters really aren't playing hardball, but Acosta was being pretty aggressive in his questioning, which was good.
Well, they've got to break through that armor-plated bullshit, you know, that the president does spews out. But yeah, maybe we need to redefine the role of press vis-a-vis or leaders. I don't know. If nothing, maybe this trial will, this lawsuit will, not trial, but lawsuit will maybe set some boundaries. I don't know. Maybe start some precedences.
You're going to have to excuse me for a second. Now, Paul, every so often, you know, let your cat in or out. I have to go let my dog out.
Oh, good, good. I'm glad.
I'll be back in 2 minutes.
Also a slave to their animals like I am.
Okay.
Excellent. So, I mean, do you think about these things, Brian, when you see all that, or you just take that in stride? You see the, the friction.
Here's Bruiser.
Oh,
hey,
it's
Bruiser,
adorable.
How you doing?
Hold on. I don't have him on screen yet. Hold on for a second. Oh, what an adorable dog.
He's 15 and a half.
Is
he can't hear
is,
you.
Is he a beige? Is he a beige Scotty by any chance?
No, he's a white miniature schnauzer.
Oh, really? He's adorable.
Come on, buddy. Let's go.
He's adorable. Oh, wow.
Cheryl says, hey, Bruiser.
Adorable dog. I lost you there, Paul. We were talking about Acosta and everything.
Yeah, I mean, when you see that exchange going on between the press and, you know, a very boorish president, do you think about, allowable exchanges and how aggressive can you be? Is, you know, what's the cap on that? Or are you just used to this charade that goes on?
Every president has, I mean, at least in my lifetime, every president has had to deal with this. I remember when Dan Rather and Nixon went at it. You know, he said, for example, Nixon said to Rather, Mr. Rather, are you running for something? And then Rather had a retort saying, no, Mr. President, are you? I've seen Rather get busted up in the ribs. I mean, they don't like the press in general. I mean, this has happened to everybody, but it's...
And the press has to be careful. They don't want to be, you know, come across... Because Rather could do that, come across as egomaniacs, you know, and Rather did have that tendency. So they've got to be careful as well.
I understand that, but there's, you know, there's just some reporters, you know, it's just very good reporting. They're doing what they have to do. They're doing their job. Acosta didn't give up, and I give him credit. If you remember, he did not stop. The guy did what he's supposed to do. He followed it up.
He was
treated like shit. And,
you know, the intern Nazi went after him.
Right.
But, you know.
And then we had Peter Alexander defended him well. Because, and he did a much better job than, John Roberts from Fox, who waited until after the broadcast to do it.
I mean, Chuck, I know you're a lawyer and you're not a journalist, but how would you have handled it? Would you have said, get off me, you Trump Nazi bitch? Or, you know, would you have, you know, given way? How would you have handled that, do you think?
Oh, when the intern came to grab the...
Would you body slammed her? I mean, what would you have done?
No, I try to behave professionally in those, you know, situations.
In the public eye.
Paul, it seems like you've had some personal experiences yourself with some women. Are you alluding to something in the past that I shouldn't discuss? Just kidding.
Because, Brian, you know me, I would have blown up.
I know.
Trump Nazi what bitch. You,
Paul has this demeanor.
That probably would not have been a good idea.
No, you don't want to get physical. Paul's interesting. Paul's very polite. He handles himself well. But he does have a fuse that can go in a completely different direction. He gets like a sailor at some point, and it usually ends with the word bitch. And I've seen it many times. And that's why it's so ironic that I was accused of being the cursor on this channel. And Paul certainly can throw the words about, so to speak. So
and then, you know, Trump was the one that was really egging her on. You know, he said, take that microphone from her, right? From him. And because after all, Trump doesn't do anything himself. He's always got some heavy to do the work, right?
Absolutely.
Well, so he's hiding behind her skirt, literally.
Yeah.
Literally.
And in this case, it was a young woman, you know? I mean, but it doesn't matter. Trump's not going to do it. You know, he's the biggest wuss of all, you know?
Absolutely. Look, he's a five-time draft dodger, correct? Or at least three. Yeah. I mean, it just tells you right there. Man's a draft dodger. And by the way, he's the one during Parkland who said he would have gone in there alone and done what he had to. That's bullshit.
Yeah, it's total bullshit.
You know, he is full of shit. So
he would have taken Chuck's gun and gone in there and done business.
You know? I don't see anybody, you know, of the top names in the Republican Party. I don't see Lindsey Wagner taking an AK-47 and, you know, and running himself into battle. I mean, most of them are candy asses, quite frankly. I mean, I know this is getting absurd, but Trump against Obama, you know who's going to win.
Now, do you remember the book that Al Franken wrote, you know, back years ago, Lying Liars and Lies They Tell something like that? Well, do you recall that there's a chapter in there called The Chicken Shit Platoon? And it's about this hypothetical platoon in Vietnam. That's the sergeant is Ollie North, and the soldiers are Newt Gingrich and Rush Limbaugh and all of these other, you know, Republican draft dodgers,
ideologues, and it's just
hilarious chapter where they're out there and every time a shot is fired, Limbaugh flops to the ground and shits his pants.
North
is getting more and more frustrated with these guys, and he's forcing them up to battle. And he's especially, you know, pissed about Limbaugh, because not only is Limbaugh being chicken shit, but he's, you know, stinking the place up by shitting his pants, you know, every 30 seconds. So he forces them to get up and get in the battle. And so they decide they're not going to have anything of it. And their final act of courage is to frag Ollie North.
I do recall the title. What kind of impact did the book have? I mean, obviously, you were directed to it somehow. So, you know, how did the book hit? I mean, did that have much of an effect or not really?
I don't know. It was 20, 30 years ago. I don't, it was back in the early days of the Clinton administration, and Franken was still a comedian.
You missed that one, Brian, reading that book.
Well, it's funny because my wife hung out with Al Franken many, many years ago. My wife's good friends, well, not good friends, but she's pretty good friends with his cousin. So I'd like to have his cousin on the show. That would be it. Maybe we could discuss the book. I'm sure his cousin could chime in on that.
B. Murray says, should have been Ted Nugent shitting himself.
Really? Well, Ted Nugent is a nut. I mean, he may actually fight, but who cares? In general, they're more sunshine soldiers than anything else. But other things going on today. I was wondering if we could discuss Ocasio-Cortez a little bit today, what she did. I think was a bold thing to do. And while we're going against the Republicans, she went into, right up to Nancy Pelosi's office and demanded that the Democratic Party fight for the climate, so to speak.
Yeah, well, I don't know if this... I don't know if this is going to end up fracturing the party,
Well, she felt that there were some Republicans that she could, you know, that would not, I mean, that would be bipartisan, that would understand how important this is, that we basically only have 12 years according to the IPCC. So she's saying she's doing this because she thinks it's important, and then she's not, this is a non-negotiable item.
Well, it could be argued that in order to initiate change, you first have to win your party over. Mm-hmm. And I'm not convinced that the socialist wing has won their party over yet. It's still in process.
Well, may I actually show that clip, if you don't mind?
Absolutely.
Sure. Okay, yeah, so here we go. Where are we?
Rudy says Pelosi's 85-year-old. 85 years old. She doesn't give a fuck about climate.
Leader Pelosi, you come with the next speaker in the House. We need to tell her that we've got her back.
Can you hear it, Brian?
It's showing that we're pursuing the most aggressive energy agenda that this country has ever seen.
Can you respond to the Democratic Party's reversal on fossil fuel donations?
You know, I think in order for us to move forward, and what Americans are asking, not just of the Democratic Party, but for all members of government, Republican, Democratic, Independent, everyone agrees that we need to get big money out of politics, and that the way future is to figure out a way where we can govern without special interests getting in the way between us and our communities.
This is all about special interests and money.
Being a part of the Progressive Caucus, potentially, or you're forming maybe a Justice Democrat Caucus, will the Green New Deal be a part of that?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that a Green New Deal is bedrock legislation upon which we can really introduce a lot of other ideas.
So, you know, the Republicans seem to, they dominate the discussion about economics. They say that they're the party for, you know, the growth of the economy, but keeping fossil fuels in our economy seems to be more in the past. Can you talk about how your Marshall Plan for a Green New Deal would actually jumpstart the economy?
Well, we have never truly seen economic growth happen through austerity. It is when governments chart a course and when we decide as a people and as a public to be ambitious, when we make the choice to electrify the nation, when we make the choice to build an interstate highway system. It's those kinds of audacious ideas that have always driven economic growth and always driven us into technological advancement. And what I see here is a profound opportunity. There's clearly a lot of public support for making sure that we build out jobs and invest in our infrastructure. And we clearly have a responsibility to save our future. We have 12 years left before we start to experience cataclysmic disaster if things don't change, and we have to make sure that they change.
Do you think that the Republicans can move on this issue at all, or is there too much fossil fuel money in their coffers?
You know, there are some Republicans that are actually in the NOPAC caucus, I believe. So I don't think that this is necessarily a left versus right issue. This can be a true issue. I think infrastructure and jobs can be a true issue for Common Cause. I think that the party leadership has acknowledged that as well. And so this is just about making sure that we deliver on all of these things that we already know to be true.
Thanks.
Very impressive. You know, I don't watch TV, so I miss that thing. But I'm impressed. I mean, this woman is not losing sleep. And I'd like to see her run in 2020. But again, first you got to get control over your own party.
Well, let's see. That's too. No, she's too young to run.
She's too young to run.
Well, so what's the? So there's a minimum age. What's
35?
35. Yeah. So she's got a while to go. But I think she's important. She seems very intelligent. She's not that I should. I don't sound sexy, but she's a beautiful woman, and I think that will help out.
Well, with that kind of charisma, she'd blow.
Right, and I think the same thing goes for Kamala Harris. I think now Kamala Harris does have the age requirement settled. Plus, as I said before, she's African American, she's Indian, and she's female, and that's what you want.
Rudy says, hot, smart, and socialist. What more can a man want?
I mean, what's going on with the testosterone out there? I mean,
I know. We've got this kind of sex chat going all the time. It doesn't take long for a group of males.
It sounds like somebody needs to call the escort service or something.
Christ.
I mean,
Jeffrey St. Clair, the editor of Counterpunch magazine, calls her the lipstick Lenin. I want to go back to the initial point that you guys raised. I think this is indicative of exactly how we need to relate to the Democratic Party. We cannot expect the Democratic Party to act in our interests on its own. The New Deal was much more a part of labor agitation and pressure put from the bottom up than it was an act of largesse by a faction of the American ruling class. Right. Same thing with the civil rights movement. It was the civil rights movement that forced the government to act. I think putting pressure on the Democratic Party through these coalitions and organizations and factions sympathetic to them within the Democratic Party is exactly what has to be done.
Yeah, well said, Chuck. I absolutely agree with you on that. Absolutely.
And I do give her a lot of credit for her role in organizing acting as a spokesperson for it.
She's got courage. There's no doubt about it. She hasn't forgotten the reason why she was put in place.
There's one thing that makes me uncomfortable, though, and you guys have a much better understanding of all of the environmental and climate issues than I do. I'm really, kind of newly coming around to this, and in no small measure because of you, but I'm uncomfortable when the arguments for addressing climate control, climate change, and climate catastrophe are justified in terms of what they're going to do to promote economic growth. Because what we need to do may or may not induce economic growth. I think there's no question that we need to have a massive effort. That massive effort may, in the short run, have positive economic multipliers that forward economic growth, but I'm not sure that in the medium to long run, those are compatible goals.
Mm-hmm.
In other words, whether unlimited growth scenario is viable.
Right, right. Well, the problem is, and we've said this, that our brand of capitalism is definitely linked with runaway climate change. I mean, it's this 19th century brand of capitalism has to go. There's a whole bunch of stuff going on in our chat room right now. I'm not a moderator of a chat room. We're running a show, but I really urge our male members, please do not alienate our female viewers. I mean, we really want them on, and cut the sex talk a little bit if you can, or it's okay for a chuckle here and there, but and again, I'm not the moderator. You guys are all adults, I would assume, and I know Brian's bad enough calling Ocasio sexy and stuff. Yeah, I know he rings, he leads us on, but Brian doesn't go on about this. He just says a comment now and then, but
Well, I said it, if I may add, the reason why I mention that is I just think that you look at John Kennedy from the opposite end. Anybody who's attractive does help get votes. I mean, it's just a fact. It's just, for example, psychologists say that the more attractive somebody is, generally the better they're going to be treated. Like models tend to be treated better than, you know, the average people. And it's not fair. I'm not suggesting that it is fair.
Yeah, we know your motives.
But my motive, is absolutely that.
But please, gentlemen, please have respect for female members of our chat. They're valuable members to us, and I don't want them to be, feel like they don't want to, voice their opinion, because it will lead to a pile of sexist jokes and so on. So please don't do that. Okay, and thank you, of course, all for listening. So anyway, back to the discussion. I like Ocasio. I think she remembers the reason she wasn't elected. She has the vision, this idealistic vision that has not been in any way frayed by success or the fact that she's in power now. I hope that she continues to be a real prime mover within our Democratic Party, because our Democrat Party definitely went way too centrist, played ball way too comfortably.
And plus, you had Keith Ellison. Keith Ellison was in a lot of trouble, and then he at one time was going to be the top guy in the Democratic Party. I guess they're lucky. I mean, maybe they knew something ahead of time. I don't know what you guys think about that, but they gave it, to Perez instead of Ellison. But Ellison had some abuse claims, and you got to be very, very careful about that. So I guess the Democratic Party has to feel where it's going to go, but at least I think the progressive side now knows that they can make some demands where before they really couldn't. So I think things are looking up in that sense. I mean, actually, if you think about it, things are kind of strange. Paul, you are in a red state, and it's really odd, but Texas is closer to becoming a purple state than Ohio is. I mean, Ohio has gone for Obama before, but it seems like you have this large group of white non-college graduates in Ohio, in between, the cities that vote Republican. And I'm actually worried about Ohio, because it seems like they've become the red state of the North. They're almost like Indiana now. Whereas Texas, with Beto down there, it was very, very close. Do you see any chance of the Democrats coming back in Ohio?
Sherrod won, didn't he?
Yeah.
Yes, but in general, Trump won by what? 6 or 7 points against Clinton? It was just... It was a lot closer in Pennsylvania and Florida and all that, but Ohio is pretty much easily for Trump. And you've got Kasich, who, now he's another one. He reminds me of Flake in a certain sense. He tries to act like he's somewhere in between. He wants to fill the void for the Republican Party should all of a sudden they come to their senses. I think he's full of shit, too. I think he's definitely a conservative Republican. He just seems like he's not now, because he's, going against Trump to a certain degree. But he always plays this game of saying, both sides have to calm the rhetoric. No, we don't have to calm the rhetoric. We've got a nut as a president of the United States, and we have every right to be upset. So I'm not a big fan of Kasich, but I really do worry about Ohio. I think that essentially they're a red state. I mean, don't you think? I mean, you're near where Delbert Lattison is. He can hold the district for 30 years if he wants to. The people of Ohio; they're very conservative. And this is why I said it was no shock, even during Kent State, that it happened at Kent State and not at Berkeley, because you had Governor Rhodes, who's a hothead. He didn't like to see those hippies near the the RTC.
Well, I think Chuck's point remains. We need to have a bottom-up led movement, and I think Ocasio represents that. And we need to keep up the pressure.
Well, it's a warning. It's certainly
all of us. We need to keep up the pressure. We need to do what we can.
It's a caveat to the rest of the party.
This is for the future of our country and our globe. It's not, I know that platitude has been used in the past. But with the climate numbers the way they are, the direction in which the climate change is moving, this enters a critical stage. And we've got to keep the pressure going, all of us.
But and, you know what's really weird is I think Biden's numbers are still, and I don't really like Joe Biden that much, but his numbers are in polling still show that he defeats Trump in an election. I don't know why, but you know, what do you do? Do you go by the poll numbers and play it safe? I don't know.
Because I think we're a way out. I mean, I'm no fan of Joe Biden.
Neither am I.
I hate all those centrist Democrats. I hate them all. Hate them all for what they did to us, to our party. LBJ.
How about my home state of Wisconsin? Finally threw Walker out.
Right. Isn't that great?
Finally threw Walker out.
Good job.
Won the governor's position, won the state attorney general, state treasurer, got 54%. Well, I have these numbers here. They got 54% of the votes for state assembly, but only 36% of the seats. That's how gerrymandered Wisconsin legislative districts are. And that is going to be another exhibit in the gerrymandering lawsuit that was remanded from the U.S. Supreme Court back down to the U.S. District Court in Madison. But it's kind of shocking that all these states went one way. The state offices went one way, but the state legislature still remains in the hands overwhelmingly of Republicans. Meanwhile, in New Hampshire, both the House, the Senate, and we have a thing called the Executive Council went from Republican to Democrat. Both congressional seats and both Senate seats are held by Democrats. The only thing held by Republicans is the governor's office.
Well, wasn't Paul Ryan's seat was won by the Republican, right?
It was won by the Republican, yes.
Oh, wow, that's a shame.
I was disappointed in that, but the Democrat candidate was weak. He didn't have any experience. He wasn't very articulate.
Well, that congressional district, that's my hometown. That's my home congressional district. Mm-hmm. And that has been seriously gerrymandered. It used to be, you know, pretty solidly Democratic, because there were, you know, four big union cities in it, Racine, Kenosha, Beloit, and Janesville, where Ryan is from. But they added some pretty Republican areas to it to keep it, make it difficult for that thing to flip.
Mm-hmm. Well, we started rather late tonight, so I think we're going to have to close. I thank everybody. Chuck, thank you, of course, for joining us. You've been on a few times before. Our audience, thank you for joining us. You know, be patient with us. We try to run a quality show every time we're on, and it's tough when you come on every 2-3 days, sometimes back to back, always trying to bring new energy and new ideas. Chat, it was a bit of a politically oriented chat tonight, but you know, we had the heads here who you know, are quite expert on that subject, so we had to deal with that. And we'll probably be back on I'm working the next two nights, so maybe looking at Friday on. I don't know what Brian's schedule is. But, Chuck, thank you for being on.
Thank you, Chuck.
And, audience, we love you all, even if we do disagree and quarrel from time to time. Be nice to each other. Thanks. Goodbye.
Good night.